yours forever.
May you, O Lord, be renowned through all generations.
Let us sing together our opening hymn, Ye Servants of God, number 181.
Here and around the world. Equip us with your Holy Spirit to
Friends, if you look forward this day on the communion rail, you will see what are, at least in one sense, beautiful works of art. But even more than that, they are beautiful works of love and prayer. These are prayer shawls and blankets that have been either crocheted or knitted. I don't know which one each one is. By a wonderful group of disciples that meet on Tuesdays. They're called the Hands of Hope. And they do this beautiful work. The reason they do this is so that when someone in our family here as a church goes into the hospital or perhaps into a rehabilitation center or they're struggling with something in life or celebrating the birth of a child or just need to know that they are wrapped in the loving presence of God, then one of these prayer shawls or blankets is given to them. It is wrapped in prayer by the ladies that do them, and men are welcome, I've been told. But then we pray as well a blessing upon them so that they might just carry for this congregation our prayers and love for all those in need. And so I invite you now just to place a hand out as we as a congregation together ask God's blessing on these shawls. Gracious God, you have promised to be with us always, to never leave us or forsake us. Your love envelops us. It covers us like a wrap on our shoulders. It is a comfort and a warmth to our souls. May these shawls and blankets represent that love for each person that has one and for all those that need them, that they would know that we stand with them in good times and bad, in trials and sufferings and celebrations, because you have bound us together as one body, the church. So we pray your blessing upon these shawls this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You'll also see that we've printed in the bulletin for you the purpose of the United Methodist Women. United Methodist Women is a marvelous organization within the life of our church. It provides small group fellowship for those women that choose that as their vehicle, missions, studies, conference, and even global activities all around the world. The United Methodist Mission, women have been a leader in missions in the United Methodist Church throughout generations, and we are grateful for that witness. While not everyone chooses that as their small group and spiritual formation group, many of you may be either currently or have been in one of our women's circles or groups. And if so, would you just raise a hand? Let's see who's... Yeah, a number of you have found that to be a place for study and growth and mission work. And I want to invite all of us to read together the mission out loud of the Methodist Women's Purpose. The organized unit of the United Methodist Women shall be a community of women whose purpose is to know God and to experience freedom as whole persons through Jesus Christ, to develop a creative, supportive fellowship, and to expand concepts of mission through participation in the global ministries of the church. If you are interested at all in participating in United Methodist Women, please contact Janet Roberts, who is the president, but any of the women that you saw a hand go up would be glad to welcome you into a circle or a seasonal study or a mission project. The next celebration that we have is to welcome several folks into the membership of this congregation. Many of you know that almost every week we have folks that come and find this congregation, and some settle in and say, this is going to be home and family. And then some of those arrive at a point where they say, we're ready to enter into a covenant of belonging and participation as members of the church. And they are welcome. We receive all people to come by faith in Christ Jesus, and we ask questions of faith of all of them. So this morning, we have a few that are ready, and so I'm going to invite to come forward right here in front, Joe Elkins. Joe and I go back about at least 30 years in a church I served way back in Durham days. Matt and Carly Ritchie are going to come forward, and Joyce Wagner. And we're going to ask them the questions of faith. And you know, it's a good time as well for you to renew your faith. And the questions, they're very significant, but the answers aren't difficult. So if Jason or I say, do you, you say, I do. If we say, will you, I will. So on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
And I ask you, do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races?
And now I ask all of you, do y'all, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
I ask you, will you be loyal to Christ's church through the United Methodist Church? And will you support First United Methodist Church by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If you will all turn to the top of page 42, I think it is. If you're not already there. It's middle of 43. Members of the household of God, we commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. We welcome you as the newest members of First United Methodist Church. Welcome, Joe. I'll invite them to come and be at the front after the service so we can both get a picture of you, but also so that you can greet them. Let's welcome them now. We are a praying people, and so Almighty God, hear our prayers. Hear our cries for mercy and help, our petition on behalf of others and ourselves. Receive our praise and celebrations. For we know that you alone are God, you alone are worthy of praise, and you alone are the ultimate answer to all that we need. We pray that you will touch, especially those now who are sick or grieving, broken or lost, hungry, hurting, homeless. We pray that this world might see in your people a beacon of light and love, that they would be drawn by our love and generosity to your side, so that they might too experience your saving and transforming grace. We give you thanks for this church and the purpose and witness that you have called us to. And we dedicate ourselves to your glory and service, now and forever. And together we pray as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into
Amen.
like to turn in your Bible. The scripture reading today is Jeremiah 1, 4 through 9. That's on the Pew Bible, page 698. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth." Now it's time for the worship with tithes, gifts, and offerings.
Thank you.
of God is calling, number 436.
To make a comment about these knittings and crochet pieces on our altar. I have been blessed by receiving two of these. And I don't know if everybody knows it or not, but when these ladies do these pieces, they know exactly who they're doing them for, and they say prayers for that person as they make it. And then when they're all done, they pray over all of them. So there's a lot of heart and soul that goes into these, and so when we bless these, it really is a major thing. Our lesson today is about shining for Jesus, and this sweet lady has come today to tell us about our wonderful Methodist homes for children. And at these homes, children who do not have families anymore for one reason or the other, it might be temporary, it might be permanent, come to these Methodist homes, and they are shown Jesus's love and embraced, they're embraced and help them to, and are helped to feel like they are not alone. And you have a wonderful message, and thank you so much for being here. It's just wonderful. I have a little thing here, and that says,
"Shine for Jesus."
Shine for Jesus. How can we shine for Jesus in our world today, do you think? If you see somebody at school that looks like they're standing alone or they don't feel part of the group, what do you think you could do to shine for Jesus?
You can include them in what you're doing.
That would be nice. That would be nice. You know, we have a lot of people that come in that are new or transferred from another school. And in our daily life, we can see some, if we see somebody in the grocery store or something, you see somebody that looks sad, you could always say, "Well, what do you think about this chicken over here?" And I have engaged people like that from time to time. And I don't know, sometimes we can get a sense of people that are feeling sort of out there on a limb and need to have a little Jesus's love shown into their lives. And so anyway, that's our message today. And Pat, I meant to say something to you earlier. Where's she already gone? We are so talented by the people that get up here and show their talents. It's, all the singers are always so amazing, and these ladies that help on a regular basis, thank you to all. And they're shining in our lives. But we're going to sing Jesus Wants Me. No. This Little Light. This little light of mine. And if you will sing along with me, "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." Okay, and we're going to pray. If you would say a little prayer with me. Dear Jesus, thank you for all the ways you shine in our lives.
Thank you for all the ways you shine in our lives.
Help us to reach out to others.
Help us to reach out to others.
And show your love.
Show your love.
By shining every day.
By shining every day.
Everywhere we go.
Everywhere we go.
In your holy name we pray.
In your holy name we pray.
Amen.
Vision of the United Methodist Women is to turn faith, hope, and love into action on behalf of women, youth, and children around the world. Each year, this unit of women make donations to children, Methodist Children's Home. Many of us may think, when we hear Methodist Children's Home, of orphanages. Orphanages were places where children could find faith, hope, and love. And that work continues today as the organization has evolved. Cindy was here in August to speak to United Methodist Women about the program, and we welcome her back today to share with the congregation the wonderful work that the group does, and ask for your prayers and support.
Work we do at Methodist Home for Children. good workplace behavior and what is not appropriate, like taking an hour break when the boss said take a 30-minute break. So we work through all these things and we help the kids go out better prepared to live in the work world when they leave. Now, Summer's story started that when she was very small. When she was only 5 years old, Summer's mother was sentenced to a long stretch in prison. And so this little girl, and her mother was her primary caretaker. Dad was not in the home. So from that point, this little girl bounced from her father to a grandmother here, to an aunt there, to another grandmother. Nobody wanted to keep Summer permanently until finally she was begrudgingly taken in by her father's mother, who was made it clear she wasn't happy to have this little girl there. The grandmother regularly cursed at and beat this little girl with a wooden broomstick for the next 7 years. She would lock Summer in her room for long periods of time so she wouldn't be bothered with her, and she would even withhold food from the child for various reasons. So Summer obviously was not happy there, and she began to act out at school and at home in hopes that she would somehow come to the attention of the authorities and she would be taken from her grandmother's home. Well, it didn't work, so Summer upped the ante. And one day, when her grandmother was not at home, Summer really lashed out. She set her grandmother's house on fire. And thankfully, there was very little damage done and nobody was injured in this incident. But you can believe that Summer was in a whole lot of trouble. This young lady stood in front of a judge at the age of 12, and I think that he was probably trying to scare her straight a little bit. He said, I'll sentence you to 5 years in jail. Well, thankfully, Summer was instead sent to a youth detention center where she was able to continue her schooling and got some help and was able to do very well. She's very smart. She got good grades in school. And she happened to hear about our Methodist Home for Children program, the Transitional Living Program, and she applied to be accepted to that. And once she got, she was accepted. Once she got there, going directly into the mother's heart. And Kenan, you were born into the heart of our family, and we want you to be here forever. And of course, he joyfully said yes, because he's really going to live in the family. And when they went and signed the adoption papers, the little boys went with them. And after the adults signed the papers, the kids said, "We want to sign too." So the parents turned over the legal papers and let these two little boys scribble their names on the back and seal that beautiful deal. At Methodist Home for Children, we know that what we're called to do is transform lives of kids just like Summer and just like Kim. And we know that's what God wants us to do here in North Carolina. And we do it with the help of churches like yours. And we thank you so much for your gracious support, both in prayer. I cannot emphasize enough how much we covet your prayer support of what we do. We need it. We need you there fighting for us. And also your financial support. We greatly appreciate it. As Christians, we all know that answering God's call to step forward, like Jeremiah did, is often difficult. But we are called to help those who can't help themselves, whether it's participating in ministries here at church, whether it's going up to somebody in the grocery store and asking them how they like your chicken, or just letting somebody know that there's a friendly person there who cares about how they're doing. We can make a difference that we will never know for other people. And in doing so, we're reminded in Galatians 6:2 that we are fulfilling the law of Christ. We're honoring the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. And what more could we do? Last year, we were able to serve over 1,400 children and families here in North Carolina Conference. And we can see with the work that we are preparing to do this year, that number is going to grow a lot. We do not want to turn away from a single child who needs us. And we won't do that with your help. And we greatly appreciate it. There are so many more children here who need our help. So many kids who have been abused, neglected, abandoned, children living with parents who can't look after them, young people with no positive role models in their lives, kids who've made bad choices that endanger themselves and us, children who suffer from developmental delays and mental illness and other problems that keep them without help from living a happy, productive life. We want to reach every one of those kids that we possibly can. It can sound kind of overwhelming, but we know that we have God on our side this work, and we know that we have you on our side. So thank you so much for that. And we also know that for each and every one of those kids, God has a really special plan, just like he did for Jeremiah. Would you pray with me, please? God, thank you for this church and for each and every person here and for the call that you have given all of us to be your people. Help us resist that temptation to say, "Lord, I'm too young, I'm too old, I'm too busy, I'm too tired." We can always find a reason to not do your will, but remind us, please, how blessed we are when we do say, "Yes, Lord, I'll be your hands and feet here on earth." Lord, we especially ask for blessing this morning of any children that are served by the Baptist Time for Children, and for every child this morning who is suffering, lonely, afraid, or even hungry. Lord, please wrap your loved ones around them. In your most holy name we pray. Amen.
Please stand for our hymn of commitment.
Thank you.
We certainly want to give thanks for Cindy being here to share with us this inspiring word about the Methodist Home for Children, about God's call on our lives to serve and to love and care. Thank you, Cindy. Receive this blessing. The grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the sustaining fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you this day and forevermore. Amen. And now let us sing as printed in the bulletin.